Hello there, everybody. This is James Lawrence, and I'm continuing my series of teachings on the subject of Calvinism. And of course, I'm looking at those doctrines that are not true. They're false. They're flat out false. And Calvinists, of course, will disagree, and they will continue to do so. Many of them will hold on to it so firmly that they'll hold on to it to their very death. And we're just trying to mostly help those who are hearing their teachings, if that makes sense, rather than just being concerned about the people themselves being Calvinists. Hopefully the light of the gospel will come to them in the correct way, rather than them believing this predestination aspect. And this is what I'm addressing in this series, is the pre-selection, election, predestination. And it's called by those different terms, and it means that some people are literally chosen for hell. That's eternal separation from God for eternity. Others are selected for salvation in Jesus Christ, but it is only those who have an irresistible grace that comes upon them. And then they will receive Jesus Christ at that point and not before. I didn't realize a while back that Calvinism actually involves everything that happens in their estimation, in their point of view. They believe that everything a person does, even if you were to murder someone, a child, or something like that, something horrible, that's almost too much to think about. But they believe that God predestined even those activities, even those acts of violence and so forth that people do, or whatever they do. They cheat, they lie, they commit adultery, they become drunkards and so forth, and God predestined even that, even those actions by someone. You know, I didn't really realize that they went that far with it. I thought it was stuck mainly to the subject of salvation, in which they believe what I just said, that some are selected for this salvation in Jesus Christ by irresistible grace. Others are chosen for eternal hell, and they cannot change that. That God pre-selected them for it, okay? And this is not what the gospel says, and they will swear that it does say that. And what it is there are teachings by certain people that were passed down through generations, the main person being John Calvin, because they felt like he preached this Calvinism, is why it's called that, by his last name. Excuse me. And that he taught it more precisely, they believe. He did critical study, and he came up with this these doctrines through expositional teaching, expository. And so, therefore, you know, he's a great man. So, in some ways, he is exalted far much more than a man should be. Because think about it. Okay, think about this fact. People are saying, I'm a Calvinist. Well, that's the last name of John Calvin, and they're using his last name to say, that's what I'm of. I'm of Calvinism. And then other people, because of Jacobus Arminius, the man who actually countered the teachings of Calvinism, they call them Arminianist, because his last name is Jacob, last name Arminius. Okay, I think this is somewhat ridiculous, and I'm sorry to put it so straightforwardly, but I just don't think people should look at their doctrinal beliefs, their system of beliefs, if you want to call it that, according to what men have taught, okay, except for the man who was also God, Jesus Christ. Okay, but the scriptures are very clear on many things. And other things, people have different, you know, interpretations. But when it says God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, then who did he love? The world. Does that include everyone? Yes, it does. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And the Calvinists would probably say, but that has been quoted out of context for many years, and people need to put it in the context because it says something before that that does imply this, you know, this Calvinistic doctrine of pre-selection, predestination. Well, I don't believe it does at all, and I've read the whole chapter, third chapter of John, and John 3:16 is the focal point, is the main subject in that chapter, that God sent his son. Whosoever believes in him shall be saved. That means those who, you know, belief in the sense that it's being used here is total acceptance, like a child. Jesus even said that unless you become as little children and believe the gospel, you shall in no wise enter therein. So the kingdom of God is available to those who simply, on face value, seeing that Jesus died for them, shedding his blood for the remission of our sins, and after dying on that cross, he was placed in a tomb and raised from the dead 3 days later. That is the gospel. Now, kind of in a nutshell, because the story can be told so beautifully and in full, you can even see movies they've made. Some are good and some are a little bit off. You know, they're not quite on the subject of the scriptures, but they're not trying to push false doctrine. Do you kind of understand what I'm saying? Even the one they always play on Easter, the Ten Commandments with Charlton Heston, has some things in it, you know, that aren't quite what the Bible says, but a lot of it is, and so therefore we can enjoy it and still get a really good taste of the story about Moses and him freeing the children of Israel who were held captive by the Egyptians. So, you know, there are movies, and I would say that some of those are good. Just check them out, look at the reviews, and see what it is, you know, that people are saying about it and so forth, and then maybe you'll find something very good like that. But the thing is, the gospel is it, folks. It is the thing that especially is the thing we should especially teach on and not allow doctrines to come in that literally deceive people, and some of them are left wondering, am I really saved? Now, they would say, oh, no, if they were saved by irresistible grace, they're never going to doubt their salvation. Well, I would beg to differ. There are too many videos out there of people who were strongly Calvinists and in the Calvinist church, but they broke away from it because they began to sense this is not true. Okay, and they came away from it. And you say, well, they could say that about any religion. Sure, I'm sure that's true. You don't often hear that about people who were saved in Jesus Christ, which is the gospel. But you do hear it about other aspects. Now, I'm going to read a couple of questions that people have posed to me after my doing other videos. And one of them, the first one, I'm just going to do two of these, I believe. The question is, why are some of you teachers attacking Calvinism? And the person named me, and they named the Faith on Fire ministry that Brian teaches very well. I highly recommend his channel. And he named us two specifically. I'm not really sure why, because there's a lot of really good people out there teaching the same thing that we are, that Calvinism is false. And so, but anyway, he just happened to mention us too, and he knows there are others out there that do. And I said, the reasons are for us attacking Calvinism, but not really the people. I know that probably doesn't sound right, but it is because there are too many usages of the word whosoever in the New Testament. Now, it goes deeper than this, but I'm giving you examples here. And it says whosoever when it directly references salvation within the scriptures. Other passages in the Holy Bible say God would have all men to come to salvation. So he desires for all men to do this. Another verse says God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. All should come to repentance. So there are too many such references that say God does not will for any to perish, although we know they will. Now, folks, we're not teaching that no one will perish. If anyone's understood it that way, you understood incorrectly. We know people will be lost and will be given a full testimony, a full gospel message, and they will still say no to it. Okay, but God doesn't will for any to perish, as the doctrine of predestination or pre-selection or pre-election, the elect and so forth, that Calvinism talks about, rather than that God does choose pre-selection of people for hell. So they're saying that this is true, that God does pre-select people to be saved and send them for hell. Even with all these mentions I've made, excuse me, that I've made about whosoever, and that God's not willing for people to perish, but he knows they're going to. These good news terms I've used about whosoever and that God's not willing for any to perish and so forth, that I stated just a minute ago, the whosoever, as compared to God pre-selecting people for hell, are contradictive to the highest degree. So that's why we're addressing it. I know it looks like that we put down the Calvinists themselves personally, that we're putting them down, and we have directed some things in the past toward them. Sometimes you kind of have to when they really get out of line, like telling people that these children that are going to be baptized and that they're professing Christianity, that folks, those people really aren't saved and so forth. You know, they really don't need to go that far and to act like they can look into the hearts of people they don't know. So it is actually the pre-selection doctrine that concerns us regarding those who may be deceived by it. The scriptures say to earnestly contend for the faith that was once delivered to the saints, the true faith. Okay, that's Jude chapter 1, verse 3. It really has one chapter, so I'll just say Jude 3, verse 3. And it also says to mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine. Romans 6:17. Plus others that tell us to care enough to expose false doctrines and false gospels, which Paul said in another scripture, yet another one, that those who preach a false gospel are accursed. And he said it in no uncertain terms. I have stated in many videos I've done in the past that we need to even love those who persecute us and despitefully use us. I think, too, that we who have been called into this ministry of contending against false doctrines and uplifting doctrines that are true are literally commanded. We are literally commanded to contend for this faith, as it says in Jude, verse 3, and to reprove, expose works of darkness, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 11 and 12. And it is a work of darkness when people are blinded to the fact that God loves them and that he's not going to pre-select them. Some people will worry themselves sick, literally, because they think, well, I'm one of the ones chosen for hell. I can't do anything about it. And if you don't think that happens, folks, just look at some of the videos people have made about why they left Calvinism. They could not really get a grip on just maintaining that solid faith that they're saved in Jesus Christ, because we do sin, even as Christians. Some people would disagree with that. That's ridiculous. Yes, Christians do sin. Paul talked about his struggle with sin. He rebuked Peter because he did some things that were not correct, and he rebuked him to his face because Paul said he was to be wronged. So, therefore, Christians do things out of line sometimes, and they do commit sin. But it says like in John chapter 1, I think it's verses 9 and 10, but or 8, 9, and 10. It says, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. He's saying we, including himself. But he said, but if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So that's what it takes. You don't get saved over again. Now, unless you have backslidden pretty badly, then I would even suggest rededicating your life to God in prayer. God, please receive me back, and please, God, do not take your Holy Spirit from me. I need you, Lord. Praise God. I want Jesus to be the Lord of my life. And I have failed at that, so that's what a person does. They pray for that. But I agree with the man who said this about that we should love each other. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 11 and 12, Jesus warned the disciples that leaven, or yeast, he's using it in a parable, which represents false teaching, can infiltrate people. It's like dough used for certain breads. The yeast spreads and enlarges that loaf of bread. He told them to protect against this spiritual leaven. So I agree with the man about us loving each other. It's totally true that we should love our neighbors, even those that teach falsely. Did you know we should love even them? Of course. They may be wolves in sheep's clothing, but if they're human, there's always that spark of a chance that they will draw away from that and into the arms of the Lord Jesus Christ in true, sincere, heartfelt faith that is not of their own. It is the gift of God, for by grace are we saved, not merited by anything we've done, and not of works, lest any man should boast, for we are saved in Jesus Christ unto good works. That means we should love each other. You know, that's what it leads to. We can still express, however, our strong disagreement when teachings that are leading our fellow Christian neighbors astray are happening. It's leading them away from the true gospel, which means good news. Is it good news to say, well, brother, I hate to tell you this, you may be predestined for hell. You'll just have to kind of think about that. Not a very good news thing to say to somebody. Lastly, I want to talk about one man who said that Calvinist teachings, they're vying for spiritual trouble and bad consequences for their lives, and maybe their eternal lives. And I agreed to what he said. They do seem to be like the little boy, I say, in reply to him, who pokes at a caged lion with a stick. The lion will eventually lunge at the boy. You know, Satan is compared in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, be sober and be vigilant, he says in there to Christians, for your adversary, the devil, walking about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. So I just said the lion will lunge at the boy if he keeps poking that stick at him. His point in the comment he made about it not mattering how people understand their salvation, if the predestination doctrine of Calvinism didn't exist, is also a true observation. Let me explain. Why do we have to know every little aspect of how did Jesus save us? What did he do those 3 days, before he was arisen to heaven? He was resurrected from the dead. What did he do? What precisely did he do? We don't know. But we do know that he that ascended also first descended into the lower parts of the earth. I believe that he was preaching the absolute destruction of the works of evil, which will become manifest as time goes along. Not yet. There's still wars, rumors of wars, and all these bad things that Jesus said will take place. He even said it this way. These things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. So he talked about a lot of different things, but like I'm saying, people don't have to understand every little thing about it. And when Calvinism comes in with this predestination thing, it causes people to have to think more deeply about their salvation. It really does, if they're going to look into it, because how can they be assured and how can they remain assured? I believe there are even ministers with Calvinist churches that doubt whether they really did receive that irresistible grace. I do indeed. Okay, so part of their incoherency is the fact that they contradict themselves regarding their major points of false teaching. Now, folks, I could point this out, and there's been people who have done it in other videos. If you want to look for that, look for contradictions of Calvinism, or use that type of search term on YouTube, you'll find those. And they do contradict, I'm telling you now. And you can say, they do not your understanding, brother, because you have no knowledge in this. I have as much knowledge as I care to have, and I know for an absolute fact. Have even had people witness to me about Calvinism during my lifetime. So, yes, I do know. And I've read enough in their statements of beliefs to know that this is what they're doing. So, they do contradict themselves, and I was just going to say that my wife and I do pray for all true gospel biblical teachers every night. Some of them we pray for by name. And we do this every night for all true ministers of the gospel of Jesus Christ. None of us are anywhere near perfect, those of us who do teach, and we teach against false doctrines. We're not perfect teachers. Only Jesus held that attribute. He was the greatest teacher who ever lived, who taught from the Bible, the scriptures they had then, the Torah, the five books of what they call the five books of Moses and the major prophets and so forth were available to read back then, and many of them prophesied about Jesus coming. That's the amazing thing. Okay, Jesus even read, in fact, a prophecy about him and that he would go about healing, opening people's eyes that are blind and so forth. And then he said, before he sat, after he read from that scroll from Isaiah, he said, this scripture is this day fulfilled in your ears. And they were amazed, and they were looking at each other like, who is this man that teaches with such authority? Who does he think he is? Some of them would say. So none of us are like Jesus, but we do want the gospel. We're like Jesus as disciples, but I mean, as much as we can be in our life. That's what sanctification is about, and I believe we grow in that sanctification. Some say you get it one time, it's all over. Well, the Bible really doesn't bear that out. We're sanctified more from level to level, from glory to glory, and eventually we will be glorified as Jesus was and be in heaven with him. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. So we want the gospel to be treated with sincerity and presented as well as possible from God's Word and by the help of God's precious Holy Spirit, who guides us and helps us to preach correctly from God's Word. Yes, we do expository teaching, as the Calvinists say, must be done, but at times we do add stories in, and Jesus did that, and others and the disciples told about things that happened to them, like Peter on the roof of a man's home, and I think it was Joppa, and he talked about the sheep that came down and had animals all in it. But so it was kind of like a vision, but he related that to the disciples. Well, this wasn't an exposition from God's Word. It was a personal event that happened to him. It's just so many examples of that it's not funny. So when they say, what you're doing, brother, is not expository teaching. You must learn to exposit from the Word of God directly and then into the ears of the hearers. Well, I think we're doing that. I do. So anyway, we love the Holy Scriptures. We love the Lord very, very much. And we want everything to be taught correctly and for people not to be deceived in terrible ways. Okay? Thank you so much for listening to me. I went longer than I thought. I was going to shoot for 20 minutes. And it's 23 minutes almost. Going toward 24, so let me say goodbye to you, and also to remind you that I'm going to keep talking about this Calvinism subject. Some things it may seem like I'm running into the ground, but people are not, they're hard of hearing, not really hear, but it's they're not thinking about what you're saying. They're just not doing it. You can tell. So they need to hear it. But there'll always be differences in each of the teachings, and I think you'll enjoy them. So please keep following this series of teachings, and I appreciate it. God bless you. Jesus loves you, and he's coming soon. Bye-bye for now.